Everyone, good afternoon, good morning. My name is Kate Fry. I'm the Chief Executive Officer here at America's Blood Centers. And I officially get to welcome you to the very first Blood Advocacy Week. That is such an exciting thing for me to say. And of course, it wouldn't be possible without all of you who are on this call and all of our amazing partners out there really from across the country. So just as quick background, America's Blood Centers is the Association of Community Blood Centers that collect about 60% of the US and 25% of the Canadian blood supply. And so I do wanna first recognize the commitment of our more than 50 partners joining us in this first Blood Advocacy Week. We are so excited at that incredible response from so many different types of organizations, from patient organizations, from provider organizations, from blood centers, from community advocates, student organizations, and so much more. Thank you for being part of this incredible effort. I also would be remiss not to recognize Fresenius Kabi, who is our sponsor of this week and really has made much of the work possible. So thank you to that entire team. You know, we're going to hear a lot today about the trends impacting the blood supply and the changes we need moving forward. And really, this is what this week is all about. But first, I want to speak for a moment about how this week came to be. We often say that blood centers can't do the important work of supporting the nation's blood supply on their own. It takes everyone impacted by blood to do their part. From members of the blood community and agency decision makers to legislators and advocates to providers and patients. This week puts this notion to the test. Because it isn't about ABC or any one organization, it's about what we can do together when we raise our collective voices and advocate together for life-saving changes that strengthen the blood supply and the millions of patients that rely on it. These are changes that will save lives in your communities, and maybe even lives in your own homes. Because the truth is, every single one of us will know someone who has relied on the life-saving power of blood at some point in their lives. Many of us have even been that person. Our hope is that over the next few days, we can come together, break through the noise, and communicate just how important blood is. We will advocate together for policy changes that will strengthen the blood supply, diversify the donor base, and make sure blood is available for all and every patient in need. We encourage everyone to visit www.bloodadvocacyweek.org. There's an incredible website filled with resources for every single day of this week. There are social media content on that website that you can share relevant to every day's topic. You can also write your members of Congress about the topics we'll be talking about to help make the important reforms you'll hear about a reality. Blood is unique in our healthcare system. It can't be made in a lab, and its availability is only assured by the generosity of blood donors throughout our nation that roll up their sleeves and give of themselves to help save and sustain lives. It takes all of us doing our part, and I look forward to seeing what we can do together during this important week. It is our hope that Blood Advocacy Week is just the start of exciting collaborations that will continue long after Friday. To get things over, I would now like to turn it over to Stacy Syme, President and CEO at LifeServe Blood Center and Chair of the ABC Policy Council, who will be moderating today's event. Thank you all again. And Stacy, the mic is yours.
Thank you, Kate. This is such an exciting week. And I know I'm preaching to the choir, but we really can't do the work that we do without donors. And I always think it's fun to start these types of sessions with just a reminder of the amazing work that we do. So I'm going to share a photo. And so I want to introduce you to this beautiful little girl. She's 3 years old. She has leukemia and is receiving blood transfusions every week. And realistically, every 2 seconds, someone in the United States needs blood. A majority of those individuals being transfused today woke up not realizing that they would be relying on a volunteer to save their life. And realistically, they didn't realize that they would be relying on you. Prior to the pandemic, we were all forecasting changes ahead with the way we needed to recruit and retain our volunteer donors. But the pandemic has really just heightened those challenges. Finding ways to ensure that hospital patients like this little cutie have the blood that they need is becoming more and more of a challenge. And I know at our center, along with all of yours, that we're all taking steps and taking steps to try and change the dynamics of what's going on with our blood donors. We're in fact moving from a strategy of focusing on where someone would donate where they work to donating where you live. But that strategy is really being challenged currently by the way our licensure with donor sites is set up. It's challenged because currently you have to have an FDA inspection and hop through several hoops to be able to get your donor center licensed. But if you were collecting it on a mobile blood drive, it wouldn't be as challenging. Little girls like this are challenged by the fact that we have to think differently. Our regulators have to think differently. And I think that's what this week really brings to all of us, is a way for us to talk about the things that are going on in the industry in bite-sized pieces and really learn enough so that we can advocate not only with our regulators, but with the people who are our elected officials and even possibly just within our own community. And so ultimately, I want to thank you for doing the work to save beautiful little girls like this. And I want to thank you for really joining me in this exciting week. We're going to kick off this week with a really great presentation by Dr. Rebecca Free from the Centers for Disease Control. And she is going to discuss the National Blood Collection and Utilization Survey results. And I think this is such an interesting survey because as we think about it, it really does allow us to get information on exactly what's going on in the industry. So I am gonna hopefully, Leslie, stop sharing my screen, which it is not cooperating right now, so that Rebecca can share her slides. This all worked seamlessly a moment ago. Thank you.
I think I just took over from you.
I think you did.
Okay.
Excellent. So Dr. Free, we are really excited to hear from you. So thanks for joining us today.
Well, thank you so much for having me. I am happy to be here, and I will be presenting the background of the National Blood Collection and Utilization Survey that we conduct and going into the findings from the most recent survey, which is from 2021. And yes, as mentioned, my name's Rebecca Free. I'm a medical officer at CDC in the Office of Blood, Organ, and Other Tissue Safety. And our office investigates infections that are transmitted through blood transfusions, solid organ transplants, and tissue products. And then we also conduct this national survey, large national survey, every other year on blood collection and use. So I'll cover kind of an overview and just basics of the survey design, and then, as I mentioned, results from the 2021 survey, kind of shown in context of trends over time. And then specific to this most recent survey, we included a supplemental section, just a few questions on 2020 data, so the calendar year 2020, and that was to capture information on how the COVID-19 pandemic may have impacted blood collection and use. The National Blood Collection and Utilization Survey, or NBCUS, is administered by CDC and OASH and conducted every 2 years. The survey's main overall objective is to quantify blood and blood component collection, distribution, and transfusion nationally. This allows us to develop reliable national estimates of blood collection and use that are then used to estimate blood demand, project future blood needs, and inform policy decisions. And importantly, this is the only source of national data on blood collection and use that is generalizable and nationally representative. National surveys of U.S. blood collecting centers and transfusing hospitals have been conducted intermittently since 1971. And I've included here just a timeline. As you can see, there were 9 surveys conducted with NIH support from 1979 to 1994. The Office of the Assistant Secretary for Health launched the standardized and biennial NBCUS as we know it today in 1997. And that was conducted by AABB with support from the US Department of Health and Human Services from 1999 to 2011. And then most recently to present, 2013 to present, CDC and OASH have jointly administered the survey. And as I mentioned, it occurs every other year. The 2021 specifically NBCUS was organized into 4 sections. Section A collects general information. So this is information like the contact information for the person completing the survey and the city, state, and name of the facility. Section B is for blood collection centers, and this collects information on blood collections, processing, and testing during 2021. And all of the surveys are conducted, I should have mentioned, in even-numbered years. For the previous calendar year, so the odd number calendar year's data, so January 1st to December 31st of 2021. Section C is for transfusing facilities, and this collects information on blood transfusions during 2021. And then, as I mentioned, there were 2 supplemental sections in this most recent cycle on collections and transfusions during 2020. And this was just a handful of brief questions that asked about collection and use to ascertain the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic on the blood supply, as I mentioned. Each NBCUS cycle, the following facilities are surveyed: acute care hospitals, hospital-based blood collection centers, and non-hospital or community blood centers. Looking at acute care hospitals first, the sampling frame, which refers to the entire population from which the sample of facilities is drawn, was determined using the 2019 American Hospital Association's annual survey database. Certain facility types are excluded, and this is the same as in previous survey cycles. So hospitals that perform fewer than 100 inpatient surgeries a year, hospitals that aren't in the mainland US, I guess, including Alaska and Hawaii, and then military, Department of Justice, rehabilitation, long-term acute care, and psychiatric hospitals are all excluded. Hospitals that perform between 100 and 999 inpatient surgeries a year were randomly sampled at a rate of 40%. And then the largest hospitals, those performing 1,000 or more inpatient surgeries a year, are sampled at 100%. And that just means that they're all included, all invited to participate. So in 2021, overall, there were 2,754 hospitals sampled for the NBCUS. The sampling frame for our blood centers was determined using the FDA's Blood Establishment Registration Database and the ABC members list. And based on these data sources, 83 hospital-based blood collection centers and 53 non-hospital community blood centers were identified for the 2021 survey, and all of these were included. They were all sent an invitation to complete the survey. This slide outlines the timeline. I've touched on a little bit of this. It outlines the timeline of the survey cycle itself. And I think the main things to point out here are that this happens over a 2-year period. The survey, and we're actually starting the process for the next survey, which will be the 2023 survey. So around summer of 2021, we started developing the survey in REDCap, testing it in REDCap, making changes based on, you know, prior comments that were raised. It says my internet connection is unstable, so I hope I'm still being heard. And then we spend several months confirming contacts for each of the facilities that are surveyed. We launched the survey this past cycle in early March of 2022, and then have a submission deadline at the end of May, so a little bit over 2 months. We spend some time following up on incomplete responses, and then analyze the data. And currently we're in the process of publishing the third paper. So we published three papers each survey cycle. The first two have been published in Transfusion just as of a week or two ago, and we hope that the third one will be soon. In terms of the analytic methods we use sampling weights to account for non-responses. Blood centers and hospitals are stratified based on size, and then respondents are weighted by strata to adjust for non-responses within each of those. Data used to estimate missing data. We specifically use multiple imputation method. And then for the most part, final estimates are calculated for national collection and transfusion values. These are point estimates with 95% confidence intervals. So I'll now summarize some of the 2021 findings. We've been interested in consolidation among community blood centers for the past several years. Chart is showing data from 2017, 2019, and 2021. And as you can see, there was significant consolidation of smaller facilities within larger facilities between 2017 and 2019. But that has largely stabilized and seems to have potentially reached a steady point at currently. The decline in the number of hospital-based blood collection centers has continued, but also seems to be doing so at a slower pace. For the survey, and that was no different this year. As you can see, I'm presenting by facility type. So for community blood centers, there was a response rate of 93%. For hospital-based blood centers, a response rate of 75%, and for acute care hospitals, a response rate of 76%. And this includes over 2,000 of those transfusing facilities. This slide is kind of busy, but contains a lot of important information. And this is one of the main tables from the main paper, the main NBCUS paper from this year. And it shows the number of whole blood and RBC units collected in 2021. And please note for a lot of these tables that these are expressed in thousands. So we've included totals for blood centers and hospitals, and hospital-based blood center data is included here with the hospital column. And then the combined total, which is the hospitals plus blood centers. A couple of things to highlight here are the total number of units collected. For 2021, there were 11,784,000 units collected. 366,000 of these were collected by hospitals or hospital-based blood centers, and this is equal to approximately 3% of the total. The bulk of collections in 2021, not surprisingly, occurred at community blood centers. And another important thing to take away from this table is how this year's results compare to what we saw in 2019. Although this is only a snapshot in time, it's important for helping us understand trends over time. You can see, for example, that the total supply was relatively stable between 2019 and 2021, with about 11.6 million units collected in 2019 and about 11.8 million units collected in 2021. This represents an increase of 1.7%. However, given the margin of error, these findings are very consistent. It's interesting to note that a slightly larger share of the supply in 2021 appears to be from apheresis RBC collections. The number of allogeneic and directed whole blood units collected was relatively stable. And interestingly, autologous whole blood collections decreased from 5,000 units in 2019 to 3,000 in 2021, which represents a decrease of 47%. However, because these are such small numbers, this includes a potential large error, so significance shouldn't necessarily be read into this. In addition to collections, we also look at the number of units rejected. While the number of units rejected for other reasons seems to be pretty stable between 2019 and 2021, the number of units rejected on testing increased by 17.5%. We can't tell from NBCUS data what specific reasons might be driving this, but we looked back at past NBCUS results, and this number seems to be increasing over time. Part of this is likely due to the fact that requirements like babesia testing have been added over time, over this time period, but it's an interesting finding nonetheless. After accounting for rejected units, we have the total available supply. What we see here, looking at differences between 2019 and 2021, is that if there was an impact to the blood supply due to COVID-19, we seem to have rebounded. And the last thing to look at in this table is outdates. This number seems to have fallen slightly from 2019, although as you can see, because the confidence interval is fairly wide, this might not be significant. Looking now at the number of whole blood and RBC units transfused in 2021, again, these are expressed in thousands. There were almost 10.8 million transfusions in 2021, and this appears to be fairly stable from the number in 2019. It's interesting to note, so here I'm going to pull forward this total available supply from the previous slide to show it next to the total transfusions. And you can see that the total available supply in 2019 left very little room for outdates, and that now in 2021, it's much more balanced. This graph shows the number of RBC units in millions distributed, and that's the solid red line, and the number of RBC units transfused, the dashed green line, over time from 1992 to 2021. From 2008 to 2000, in 2008, here is the peak. 2008 to 2017, the number of distributions and transfusions both decreased. Between 2017 and 2019, distributions continued to decrease while transfusions increased, although this was non-significant. And most recently in 2021, the point estimate for the number of transfusions, for distributions is slightly higher than it was in 2019, and the point estimate for the number of transfusions is slightly lower than it was. However, these differences are also not significant and overall suggest that both distributions and transfusions may have stabilized. This graph shows trends in the rates of RBC collections and transfusions per 1,000 population, again from 1992 through 2021. RBC collections are again shown in the solid red line and RBC transfusions by the dashed green line. And as you can see, the gap between RBCs collected and transfused has narrowed over time. As I previously mentioned, there were decreases in blood collections and transfusions from 2008 through 2017. And here I've circled the peak in 2008. The peak for collections was 86 units collected per 1,000 population and 49 units transfused. And then in the 2021 results, we had 56 units collected per 1,000 population and 33 units transfused. Looking now at platelets, plasma, and cryoprecipitate units collected in 2021, we can see that the number of apheresis platelets, total plasma, and cryoprecipitate units collected have all increased since 2019. The number of whole blood-derived platelet units collected, however, has decreased. I'm going to switch gears briefly to show data on blood collection and use during 2020. The short supplemental sections we added to last cycle's NBCUS allowed us to capture information on the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic on the blood supply and use in the United States. The added questions were on monthly collections and transfusions in 2020 and included the following. For blood collection centers, we asked how many whole blood collection procedures were completed, how many apheresis platelet units were distributed? Did your institution collect convalescent plasma from donors? And if so, how many COVID-19 convalescent plasma collection units were collected? And then for the transfusing facilities, we asked how many units of allogeneic red blood cells were transfused and how many apheresis platelet units were transfused. And this table shows results from those five main questions we asked regarding monthly practices, converted to yearly totals so that we could compare the year-to-year data. 2020 results are shown here in the middle column, 2019 on the left, and 2021 on the right. As you can see, there appears to be a slight decrease in the number of whole blood collections and red blood cell units transfused in 2020, compared importantly to 2019, but also to 2021. The decrease appears to be more pronounced in the number of RBC units transfused. For apheresis platelets, both distributed and transfused, there was no similar gap seen in 2020 compared to 2019. In fact, for both of these, the opposite was seen, a slight increase. Additionally, the overlapping competence intervals suggest that no significant differences were observed between 2020 and 2021. And for COVID-19 convalescent plasma, there were 603,000 units collected in 2020 and 378 in 2021. The main takeaway from this data is that the most pronounced decrease we saw, again on an annual basis, from 2019 to 2020 was in RBC transfusions. And this decrease was minimal and possibly not statistically significant. So we also looked at the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic on blood supply and use by month. And that's what these next couple of graphs are showing. For whole blood collections in red and RBC units transfused in green, we did see a significant dip around April 2020 for both, although the dip is more pronounced for whole blood collections. And then also interestingly, the decrease in transfusions appears to have started first. And I think it's important to note that both of these have rebounded by the end of the year. You can see at the far right hand side. A similar pattern is seen for apheresis platelet distributions and transfusions, shown here in the bottom graph. Again, we have distributions in red and transfusions in green. The dip around April 2020 is seen for both. And again, both have rebounded by the end of the year. Overall, data from the 2021 NBCUS suggests that both blood collection and transfusion in the United States has remained stable since 2019. During 2020, although there were month-to-month fluctuations, drops in collections corresponded roughly to decreases in transfusions, and the decreases in transfusions appear to have occurred first. On an annual basis, there was only a slight decrease in the total number of whole blood collections and RBC units transfused in 2020 compared to 2019. Collections and transfusions had rebounded by the end of 2020. And thus, the data from 2021 suggests that any impact on the nation's blood supply and use from the COVID-19 pandemic seemed to be transient. And there were a lot of people involved with this survey and collecting this information and analyzing it, and I've just acknowledged some of them here.
Dr. Free, I found that information remarkably interesting. And so I really appreciate the fact that you were able to kind of take those surveys and present it in a really bite-sized fashion for all of us. And I know as I think of our own organization, it seems like I can absolutely see those trends you were talking about. I know there's probably questions for you, but we're going to hold questions. So as a reminder, and I know I've seen some of this come across in the little chat, there is a Q&A feature that's been activated for this presentation. So please do put your questions in the Q&A box and we will process those at the end. So we are now going to welcome Shanna Hughes, who is an assistant investigator at Vitalant Research, and she is going to share some really interesting information regarding our blood donors. Shanna, are you available?
I am, and so excited. Let me see if I can share my screen. And are you seeing the full screen of the slides?
We are, and we have your screen and your video, so we are good to go.
Okay, great. I just want to start out by thanking you, Stacy and Kate, and everybody at ABC who's organized Blood Advocacy Week. Such an important thing for us all to be doing together, and I'm sure quite a lot of work. I'm grateful for the invitation to speak today. I am Shauna Hughes, and I'm an assistant investigator at BRI. I'd like to use my 15 minutes of fame, if you will, to talk about social science and blood donors in the US. Just want to say right up front, I have no disclosures to make, no conflicts of interest, but I would ask everyone to take my comments as indicative of my own sort of perspective and opinions rather than that necessarily of Vitalant or BRI. Let's see if I can get the slides to advance. Great. Sometimes there's a delay. Before diving in, please do let me acknowledge that I am presenting to you today from the San Francisco Peninsula in the US state of California, which is the unceded ancestral homeland of the Ohlone peoples. I would call on all colonizing governments to honor Native people past and present, and to work with them on their claims and connections to place. So with that accomplished, let's just ground ourselves for a minute in the why behind my talk today. Although I will say, Stacy, that photo, I think probably did it way better than this very blurry graphic that I have borrowed from AABB. But this is the supply trend graphic that I have monitored potentially obsessively since I joined VRI in 2021. We want, all of us that are here today, we want these lines to hover far more closely around the optimal supply level than the critically low supply level. And so that's why we talk about donors, that's why we talk about the supply, because we want to meet the needs of patients. And we've touched on, you know, some of the trends in the donor pool from a statistical perspective. Thank you, Dr. Free, that was really great. And as unequivocally welcome as some of those findings are, I think no one here would see them as a cause for complacency with regard to the blood supply, particularly because there are such widely recognized threats to our voluntary non-remunerated donor model. Assuming lots of people already are familiar with these, so I'll just run through them very quickly. Decreasing donor retention is obviously a huge problem. This is partly due to more deferrals. It's partly due to fewer people becoming first-time donors, especially younger people. Also, the donor pool just aging and people aging out. We have, as Stacy mentioned, COVID and the massive disruption that caused to established collection practices. Well, I did see the other new publication from the NBC US suggest Dr. Free went over this, a minimal annualized decline between 2019 and 2020. I will say the nuances behind those numbers are probably pretty important, and I would bet that the people involved in collecting those units did not feel it was the same. There's also confusion, or competition for individuals who are willing and able to provide blood or donate, obviously without being incendiary. I'm referencing the for-profit plasma collection industry. We have obviously also sort of as an effect of COVID-19, the constraints that blood centers face in terms of their workforce, resources, supply chain issues. There are always and will always be competing community crises and local factors, but those are things that are sort of part of the model. And as has been called out by the DHHS report in 2020, we have a lack of contemporary understanding of donors and motivation, which leads me to ask a fairly simple question. What do we know about US blood donors? In some sense, we know a fair amount. I mean, first and most importantly, as we all know, donors are the bedrock of our volunteer-based blood system in the US. And without them, there is no transfusion medicine. So most empirically, we know they're overwhelmingly white. We also know, as I've already said, the donor pool is aging, and both of these trends and statistics prompt some degree of concern over the sustainability and sufficiency of the supply. But I'll just briefly highlight, I mean, if you're an academic like I am, you know that interesting questions about transfusion medicine, including donors, are being raised all the time in the literature. Here is a recent publication that investigates first-time donor return during the pandemic. It compares COVID convalescent plasma donors to non-CCP donors. They did this by aggregating data from 13 blood collection organizations. They looked at that in terms of race and ethnicity, gender and age. Spoiler alert, the donors more likely to return were over 40, female and white. That's actually not what I wanted to talk about. I wanted to highlight just one sentence that I've italicized for you on the screen. It says, the motivation of a first-time CCP donor may be different than that of a non-CCP donor. Now, aside from completely agreeing with what they continue to say about the need for further research, I would just point out that particular sentence is speculation. We don't know if there are differences in motivation, and we can't know unless we ask. To be fair, that would be beyond the purview of this publication, and studies may have been conducted, and those publications may be forthcoming, but right now we don't know a lot about donor motivation during COVID, and that's in part an example of a larger trend, which is in the US, I would say roughly since 2015, we tend not to ask about donor motivation, at least in a way that would give research participants the maximum latitude to tell us what's important to them. So this gets to my broader point about why don't we have the social science research that we need to inform that contemporary understanding and really drive recruitment and retention? Well, there are lots of things that I could say. I could talk to you for 20 minutes about each of these, but I will try to get on the soapbox only briefly. First, I'd like to say there's a predominance of just a few explanatory paradigms and approaches in this field. Now, explanatory paradigm, this sounds like a big bunch of jargon, but by that, I just mean a set of connected ideas that includes a sense of how things work in the world, and therefore what research questions are important to ask and how should we interpret the responses. So these are often associated with academic disciplines. And in terms of academic disciplines, most of donor research that we do here in the States comes out of psychology and marketing. There are other contributors to be sure, but those are the lions, if you will. And most of the data that we have are collected through surveys or through cognitive or behavioral intervention type approaches. Now, please note, I am not saying that any of this research is bad or unnecessary, quite the contrary. In fact, let's all take just a moment and offer a round of applause for Dr. Christopher France, who is the Distinguished Professor of Psychology at Ohio University. He has for many years engaged in rigorous, theory-informed research to understand donor motivations and also to help donors overcome donation-related challenges. Lots of blood centers have worked with him. All of these people deserve our thanks, if not a lifetime achievement award. But I will say, social science includes more than psychology. It's also economics and political science and sociology, and dear to my applied medical anthropologist heart, anthropology. What we know, and this is true in research in general, how we look at a phenomenon influences what we see. Now, I'll give you a simplified example. If you are standing at the front of a room, you have a particular perspective. You see certain things. If I am standing at the back of a room, I have a totally different perspective. I see different things, but we're both seeing things that are there. And we cannot tell what's important to pay attention to until we have the whole picture. That is, until we put our perspectives together. Research on blood donation is no different. And that's why I would say that we need multiple perspectives, disciplines, and research methods to enrich our understanding of donors. That just is a long way of saying, in addition to what we already do, we need different kinds of research, particularly research that prioritizes donors' perspectives and lets them tell us. That would allow us to focus on new kinds of questions like holism or the way things are connected in a system, context, why people do what they do under certain conditions and not others, or why certain kinds of people do things more than others. And key for me is meaning, the meaning people assign to things in their lives, that they use that meaning to make further decisions, to really engage with the world around them in the ways that we want or the ways that we wish they would change. So all of that, sorry, I lost my mouse. I'm trying to forward the slide. There we go. That pushes forward a further issue, which is another difficulty is the structure of the US blood system, particularly in comparison to, say, our cousins, where they do great donor motivation research like Canada or Australia or the Netherlands, the UK. We have a very fragmented blood system, and that poses challenges for researchers because national or large data sets are really difficult to assemble. I mean, look at the coordination and effort it requires to come up with the NBCUS. It's a lot. And if you're going to query things in a very detailed way, it would be even more. Coupled with that, in-house researchers, social science researchers are extremely rare. And that's important because donor data is so sensitive, as it should be. But that creates access challenges for people outside of donor centers or donor blood collection organizations who might want to collaborate with us and help us come to these answers that we need so desperately. In short, partnerships, research partnerships are necessary, but those require time and resources to establish and maintain. Which raises a further point, funding. And that's a big reason why a lot of us are here. There's not enough of it. We all know it. That's both for blood centers to do the things they need to do operationally, to come up with new strategies to try to recruit and retain donors, also for researchers who want to do the research that we need to answer the questions that are going to drive us to this next phase of sustainable and safe, adequate blood supply. One last thing I'll say before trying to move on is just the research designs of the studies that have been done. They have infrequently, and this again, in part remits to the difficulty of accessing the data, but they've infrequently connected donor self-reports, like of motivation and barriers to donation, to actual donation behavior, particularly longitudinally. It's a big undertaking to do that. They also, somewhat disappointingly, don't always explain the differences they observe. Observing the differences is hugely important, but we need to understand why different kinds of donors or under different kinds of circumstances, different behaviors pertain. Now, I would say part of the reason why we can't explain that is because we don't have those nuanced fine-grained data that would help us come up with the explanations and then test them. Finally, in this industry, potentially more than some others, because of its very heavy regulation, that last translational mile is a tough one. Going from learning what's important to packaging in a way that potentially helps us overcome challenges, to then testing that package, and then finally putting it into practice with real donors, with real staff that have 1,000 things they're doing. Man, that's a big ask. So those are some of the reasons why we don't have the research that we need. There's a lot of reasons. I'll just briefly talk about what we have been trying to do at Vitalant Research Institute since 2021 is to put together a research program where we really try to understand donors and communities. We sort this work into three large buckets, which are basically expanding and diversifying the donor base, understanding how donors think about risk and how they perceive policies, as well as focusing in a very fine-grained way on the donor experience. What is it like to be a donor? What does it mean to be a donor? What are the important touch points of being a donor? And you can see we have a lot of studies in action. I wanted to talk really briefly about just one, and I realize I've neglected to start my timer, so I will try to wrap up in a minute or two. This set of research studies, it's really quite a package, is focused on community engagement and inclusion in Memphis, Tennessee. Now, as some of you may know, Memphis is a majority-minority city, and so it offers us a lot of opportunity to learn how to do community engagement with various groups better. This is a collaboration between VRI and our operational colleagues in Memphis, as well as some local partners who have signed on to help us with this. The main things we're going to be investigating and are investigating are community perceptions of blood donation, motivators and barriers, the donor experience itself, including sort of customer service aspects, media practices and preferences, as well as feedback on our communications so we can learn better how to speak to various kinds of donors. And then we will evaluate an intervention, a community-based type intervention that we are putting into place in Memphis. So we're at the tail end, actually, of phase one, which was formative mixed methods research. We conducted focus group discussions last fall with individuals who identified as Black or African American. They sorted into groups in terms of their donor status, either an active donor, a past donor, or what I like to call potential donors, not never donors, let's not lose hope. Those discussions were really rich and very informative. And then we did a rapid analysis and pivoted those findings into a community survey so we could try to see how applicable are the findings from the focus group to a broader and more diverse group of people? These are all informing things that we're doing at Vitalant, and we hope that they're going to be informative to the industry as a whole. We will be publishing on those because it's a basic belief of ours that we're all in this together, and we want our learnings to be accessible to other people who care to apply them to their own work. We'll do a second phase where we get even deeper. We do individual interviews. We will also circle back on improved methods and materials to check in with the community and ask if we're doing better. I think that's really important. We're also going to explore in a very fine-grained, multi-method way medical mistrust. Then again, as I said, we're going to be evaluating the community-based intervention, which is separate, but around which all of this research is built. And so that is just a snapshot of what we've got going on. I will say the last that I want to leave you with is people are always just more than just donors. So in addition to the research we have, we need social science research that seeks to understand people's multiple identities, including as a donor. How those identities fit together and produce meaning in people's lives. And if we care about equity, which we should, we need to attend to how those things vary given the different constraints and opportunities different kinds of people in this country tend to experience. So this is the prerequisite for more effective donor recruitment and retention upon which so many lives in this country depend. I want to thank ABC, Donor Blood Advocacy Week, everybody at Vitalant, as well as the NHLBI, State of the Science Working Group, number one on donors in the supply. Those conversations have been really stimulating to me, as I hope they've been to other members. Everybody feel free to reach out.
I didn't know if you were going to get that all done in the time frame, but you did really well. So I'm going to go ahead and thank you. That was very interesting. And I'm sure there'll be lots of questions if we have time. I'm going to turn this back over to Kate Fry, who is going to talk about how you can advocate for the blood supply. Part of the reason for this week is to really talk about the things we need you to do as you have an opportunity to visit with your elected officials. And so Kate's going to help set the stage for a great day for us on Wednesday and into the future.
Thanks, Stacy, and thank you, Dr. Free and Shauna, Dr. Hughes. We really appreciate all the incredible presentations today. I think they've really underscored why this week is needed in terms of accomplishing change to ensure the long-term resiliency of the nation's blood supply. And as we started out the conversation by saying, we cannot do this work alone. It's why we have so many partners who have agreed to assist us with this week. And so we did want to outline the specific activities that we are asking people to take throughout the week. Next slide. There's three specific things that we would ask each of you to do and encourage your networks to join you in doing. First, support the advocacy changes that we're going to be talking about each day. As I said, there's letters already written on our website at bloodadvocacyweek.org that you can customize. This customized step is an important step. We would encourage you to share your own personal stories with blood donation. And the software will automatically be able to tell you who your members of Congress are. All you have to do is fill out that letter and press send. The more letters we're able to generate, the more awareness our issues will get on Capitol Hill and with federal agencies. We would also encourage you to be a social advocate. We have social media available to you for each and every day that we encourage you to share in your various networks and with others. And then finally, in the coming weeks, we will be organizing group sign-on letters to Congress about each one of the topics. And so for those of you who have an organizational affiliation or who may wish to just sign on as yourself, we'll be getting more information out about these letters that will be going to Capitol Hill to encourage specific action about each day. Next slide. And so I did want to just preview the rest of the events for the week. So we are having an event every single day this week that will focus on a different topic. Tomorrow's event is the one event that will happen at 3 p.m. Eastern for the week about promoting awareness of new eligibility criteria. We're very excited to have Dr. Peter Marks of the Food and Drug Administration join us for that session, as well as others, to talk about the very soon forthcoming final guidance on a move to an individual donor assessment, as well as changes that were made last year to welcome in donors previously deferred for VCJD, Med-Cal. Wednesday, ABC members will be having virtual meetings with members of Congress. There's more than 100 meetings with different members of Congress happening that day. So we're very excited about Wednesday's programming. Thursday will be another event open to anyone and everyone in the public at 2 p.m. When Time Matters. We'll be talking about access to blood, specifically in trauma and the pre-hospital setting. We know that seconds count in it when it comes to that that setting. For every 1 second that someone sooner gets blood, their chances of survival increase significantly. We'll also be talking about access to blood in the hospice setting during that event. And then finally, Friday, we'll be reminding ourselves where it all started, and that's with the patient, and talking about donor diversity and why that is critical to patient care. So we hope you will make plans to join us for each of these events. As a reminder, there is separate registration for each event on the website. Next slide. So just again, a reminder about tomorrow. Next slide. And then finally, just a final thank you. Of course, I'd be remiss not to encourage you all to donate blood. If you haven't already recently, you can find your nearest blood center at the ABC website at americasblood.org. You can also find more information at donatingblood.org. And so thank you again to our panelists, to Stacy for moderating today's discussion, and to you all for your interest in Blood Advocacy Week.
All right, Kate, it is now time for Q&A. I am going to just mention, and I messaged this to Diane, my calendar invite has tomorrow's meeting at 2 Eastern, but you mentioned it's at 3.
That's correct. I think the time might have been changed. So if anyone did register very early on, the time has changed to 3 p.m. Eastern.
Is it the same Zoom link? So for people that have it on their calendar from earlier, or would it be a different Zoom link? I think we should just clarify that so everybody knows.
It is the same Zoom link.
Perfect. All right. So we are going to go ahead and go to question and answers. I think this has been a great kickoff for the week. Kate, I think you helping set the stage for what we need to do, and really Dr. Free and Dr. Hughes really giving us some information that we can talk about with our elected officials is just such a great way to ensure that those beautiful little faces that need blood and are counting on us are able to do that. So Diane has been monitoring the Q&A. And so Diane, do you have any questions that you're gonna try and stump our speakers with today?
I don't think we're gonna stump our excellent speakers. So the first question I think is for you, Dr. Free. And the question was about donor deferrals and whether some of these changes that we're seeing occurring through FDA with some of the donor deferrals that are allowing additional people to be able to donate blood, and whether we might be able to see any of the impact on the blood supply of past changes or any changes moving forward.
Thank you for that question. I turned my video off because I'm having connectivity issues. I think it's a good point. It's I think hard to tease out sometimes what is driving some of the changes that we see over time, but definitely there have been some reversals. As I mentioned, so going back to 2008, there were pretty persistent declines observed year to year in both transfusions and collections. And then in 2019, that was the first time that transfusions had not declined year to year. And then 2021, this most recent year, is the first time that collections hadn't. And it's, I think, really hard to tease out, you know, what exactly is driving that. But as you mentioned, there have been several changes recently, decreasing the time for deferrals for different reasons, including malaria exposure or travel to a malaria endemic area, having a tattoo or piercing or scar. A lot of those deferral timeframes have changed recently. And moving forward, I think there will be interesting things to think about and look at related to some of the MSM policy changes. We're interested. We'll keep an eye out. I think the data we have is a little bit hard to say anything definitively.
The data, getting the right data is always a challenge. The next question that I have in the Q&A box is about, and this may be for you, Dr. Hughes, do you think that any of the current political fragmentation that we see have impacted donors and their willingness to donate? And is that something you think that we would be able to see in the data?
That's a great question. I think there's a lot of speculation about that. And there are a couple of studies that come to mind, not that have to do with blood donation, though. There are, of course, public opinion studies that show how fragmented public opinion is around, for example, COVID vaccines, things like that. And in some of our recent research, some of our research participants have made the link between COVID-related issues and their feelings about blood donation as blood donors, whether that is wanting to contribute in the context of a national emergency or talking about the erosion of what their perceptions about eroded trust and community collaboration and things like that. We don't have any data on that. I haven't seen any data on that. We do have a survey in the field that's intended to collect some data on that, which we'll be reporting in the next couple of weeks. So I think that's one of those things that cultural changes like that can be kind of hard to measure and particularly trace through. But those are issues that we will be exploring in the individual interviews that we do, really give people the space and the time to elaborate how they see those connections. So stay tuned. It'll be exciting.
Fantastic. I think we have time for maybe one more question. So I had another question about ways that we can look at the reason that donors that do donate blood either return or don't return, and whether that is data that we can gather and how we could best look at that moving forward so we get a better picture of who the donors are and what's bringing them in the door.
I'm not sure if that is for me. Dr. Free, do you want to say anything about that?
I don't. If you have, I thought this was directed to you. I don't have anything to say one way or the other.
I just didn't want to, just rush in. And I think that, look, this gets to part of what Dr. Free was saying before, right? And I said it too, we don't have national data. We don't know. So if we want to understand deferral and its impact on subsequent donor behavior, for example, and why do people come back after they're deferred or not, then it seems like the only way we have to go about it now is either each blood center has to essentially go through its records and identify deferred donors who don't return and who return, and then either survey or interview or focus group to find out what's going on there. And then we have to sort of compile the data, try to come to some sort of collective answer, which we could do. I mean, think about it. NHLBI has sponsored large multi-center research efforts before. REDS, we have TIMS, right? We have a precedent for a structure that allows blood centers to collaborate, and they're good at it. They're good at it when they have the support. They have the motivation. And there's lots of expertise. We could design a research protocol to be deployed across various blood collectors, and then we could work within a common framework and we could figure out what's going on. We could do that on almost anything. But again, it comes down to, do we have the resources and the framework to do it? It doesn't exist to support our efforts now, but it could.
All right, that was great. I am going to mention that Dr. Free did say in the chat that she didn't talk about deferrals, but it is going to be in their third paper, and they were 19% lower in 2021 in comparison to 2019, which I think is very good news because that helps say that we're doing the right things as it relates. All right, I know we're right at 2:00. We hope you will join us tomorrow. Thank you to everyone for participating in today about analyzing the trends that are impacting the nation's blood supply. I want to give a special thank you to Dr. Free and Dr. Hughes. We really appreciate the fact that you would join us. Kate and Diane, as always, you do such a great week. If you do have questions about Blood Advocacy Week or any of the actions that we're going to take, please contact Jeff. He's the Director of Strategic Communications and National Partnerships with ABC. He does phenomenal work, and I believe his contact information is available in the chat. And we would encourage you to visit the Blood Advocacy Week website and to register for additional events this week, and make sure if you have the opportunity to connect with your elected officials. So thanks everyone, Dr. Hughes, Dr. Free, thank you, you did fabulous. Diane and Kate, as always, you do a great job.